the triune God, three in one, that sits most high and sees mighty low. Thank you, brother. We're thanking God for all things. I'm encouraged this morning because I think I gave a little indication earlier, praise God, that, and I heard it from someone today too, saying God's made a direction change for my life. Mm-hmm. In my 67 plus years, plus mean months, 67 plus some months, years, you don't look for much change. you get kind of settled in who you are, where you are, what you're doing. But when you serve the Lord, your number of years doesn't mean anything to God. Because if he has to give you more years to get something done, he can give you more years. If he has a design to use you, he's going to use you. If he want to make a correction change, he's going to make a correction change. And in my 60 plus years, I'm settling with that even more now. Praise God. See, I've been like a rolling ball, and you know, it tastes pretty windy, and it's been pretty breezy. I don't know how it is out there now. Maybe it still is. But it's been a breezy day, a ball will roll. You know what I mean? You get a ball rolling, and you get some wind behind it. You know, it just rolls and tumbles. That's the way my life was. You say, what's he talking about? This is not true confession. No, it's not true confession. This is just me making a point. I'd be just rolling along in my comfort. Worked a job a lot of years. Did a lot of things. Married a beautiful woman. Wonderful sons. Got grandchildren. God provided all our needs. You know, you get to tend to roll along. You know what I mean? And you get comfortable. And you feel you've got where you want to be. Lord, this is where I want to be. I like this. Come and go when you want to go. You know what I mean, Junior? Nothing interferes. You just do your little thing, what you got to do, and you can go. God said, I'm going to change your role. I'm going to change your role. I'm going to slow your role. Can I say that? God said to me, at 67, he's going to change my role. Well, you know, I'm smart enough and I've been in the Word long enough to understand that I'm not going to fight against that. I may ask a question or two, but I ask it humbly. I might get a little disturbed about how God's doing it, but I've got to receive it. I've got to know that, you know, God knows best for me. And it does me well to obey God and let God make that correction change. So I'm here today telling you, Brother West is going to be a different man. All right? And it's not because I want to be. It's because God is changing me. All right? So bear with me on that, and we're going to get into something really, really good. This is a subject that we all know quite well, but for me, I needed to know a little bit more about it, and I just want to share that with you. Can I do that? Amen, amen, amen. Praise God. I've got my little book here. I've got my book here that it's a book of illustrations. 750 illustrations are in this book, all right? And it's a spiritual book. It has headlines and titles. Praise God. But let me read something to you, just a little bit on this one little illustration. And that's all it is. It's an illustration. I'm not going to stay in it long. I'm just going to read it. And we're going to move forward in that. Praise God. And I think this is the one I want. Okay, yeah, this is the one. And here's what it says here. It says, in Warren Wiersbe's Meet Yourself in the Psalms, and Warren Wiersbe is the author, he tells about a frontier town where a horse bolted and ran away with a wagon carrying a little boy. Seeing the child in danger, a young man risked his life to catch the horse and stop the wagon. Sounds real good. The child who was saved grew up to become a lawless man. And one day he stood before a judge to be sentenced for a serious crime. The prisoner recognized the judge as the man who years before had saved his life. That's an interesting paradox there. So he pled for mercy on the basis of that experience. Now here's where it gets interesting. But the words from the bench silenced his plea. And the words came back to him like this: "Young man, then I was your savior. Today I am your judge. And I must sentence you to be hanged. One day Jesus will say to rebellious sinners, during that long day of grace, I was your savior. And I would have forgiven you. But today, I'm your judge. Depart from me, ye accursed, into everlasting fire." That's the story. That's the illustration. And the point of this illustration is one word: grace. Grace. Amen? That's what we're going to get into this morning. Glory to God. I truly thank God for all things. Amen. It's by God's grace that we have all things. True, brother. Amen. I need more of God's grace. We need more of God's grace. And when we need more of God's grace, we come to find out there are a lot of things in this life that challenges us. And many things are counted as trouble. Trouble in the land, troubles in the country, troubles in the world, praise God. But what holds it all together is grace. We may cross all kinds of barriers and all kinds of lines. As the pastor talked a couple of weeks back ago, or even last week, he says, there's a line that you don't cross. If you cross this line, you've got trouble. Praise God. How many have crossed the line and been in trouble? I'm going to throw my hand up high and wide. I have crossed the line and been in trouble. Praise God. But you know what got me through? Grace. God's grace got me through, praise God. Hallelujah. When I thought I was going to lose my mind because of the situation I got myself into, it was God's grace that kept my mind in place. Amen. When I thought my prayer wasn't going to get through, it was God's grace that came through right on time. Maybe not on my time, but it came on God's time, praise God. When I need peace, and Lord, we need peace. When I thought I couldn't get any peace anywhere else, grace came on the scene and gave me peace. When I thought that peace, and I came to my understanding that I needed that peace that passes all understanding. I'm not talking about man's peace, which is temporal, but I'm talking about God's peace. Grace came in. When my children and grandchildren sometimes act up and start going crazy, and I'm going crazy, I need grace. Ain't God giving me grace? He's on time with the grace always, praise God. When I need help on my job, there's grace. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Holy Spirit will step in, but there's grace. The grace of God is everywhere. The grace of God will keep you and sustain you. Grace has not lost its power. If I had to give a mess a title to it, grace has not lost its power. We live under grace. We're in the sixth dispensation. Hallelujah. According to the word of God. Now, some of you might not know what dispensation means. It's real simple. God has divided history into segments of time. And we are, and there are seven dispensations. Guess where we are? In the sixth. We're living in the church age. We're living under grace, the dispensation of grace. The dispensation of grace began at Pentecost. And it will end when the church is raptured. Praise God. Where all the Christians and all those who are right with God will get caught up and meet him in the air. Do you want to be in that number? I don't know about you, but I want to be in that number, praise God. Because there's not much time left, saints. All we need to do is look around and see what the world has to offer, and we can say, Lord, have mercy. Help the world, Lord. But it's only by the grace of God that this world is even here today. Amen. The grace, hallelujah, in this particular time that we're living in is alive and well, and we can thank God for it. Because it's pointed out, praise God, that it occurred, this grace of the church age occurs between the 69th and the 70th week of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 24. It starts at the day of Pentecost and ends in the rapture, praise God, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And our responsibility in this particular time that we live is to believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And he is the Son of the living God. And that's supported in John 3:18. Webster describes the grace in a good way, but the Word describes it even better, praise God. Like the Word being our great defender, because the Word is God, grace is our constant covenant promise. Like he would never leave us nor forsake us. Thank be to God. Amen. Amen. The song describes it. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace. Grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. You know we're guilty. You know we've been guilty from the time we came out of our mother's womb. That guilty stamp was stamped on us. Don't let anybody fool you. Nobody came out of the womb perfect, already right with God. Nobody came out that way. Not in his life. Okay? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. That's the word. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. But grace is our constant covenant promise. Amen. And we can be happy about that. And the songwriter did it right when he said marvelous, infinite, matchless. Nothing's like grace. Nothing. Amen. You know, that's why I said this gave me, in this study, this gave me a greater urge to know more about grace. Because our brother said it already, by grace, we're saved through faith. Without grace, we would have never got saved. Jesus would have never came off his throne. God created grace, the Father. God put grace on Jesus. Ha! And through Jesus, we receive grace ourselves. To be strong in the Lord. To love God with all our heart and soul. And believe God for all that we need. Because God, through grace, provided it. Amen, amen. God can't change this thing called grace. It's already an institution. It's a covenant, praise God. He's pushed it out there in the eons of time for all mankind to benefit from. When everything else might fail, grace will never fail. When sin abounds, grace abounds that much more. Oh, glory to God. When you got some problem in your household, and you got some problem on your job, and you got some problem in the neighborhood, everything else will fail, but grace will never fail. That's why the Bible tells us that we need to walk in grace. You need to walk in the Spirit. We need to walk in the Spirit. That's all right. Amen. We need to do that. Not questioning that, but we also need to walk in grace. And let God and the Holy Spirit, praise God, in Jesus, move us and place us each day in our life where we need to be and what we need to do. Amen. So you see why I said I got a new foundation here? Hallelujah. God has given me a message for me, and he said, I want you to share it with them. Now, whoever takes what they take, you take. I ain't going to ask you nothing. All I know is I'm going to keep mine. And I'm going to try to walk in grace each and every day of my life. Because I realize a greater understanding of how important grace is. Without grace, there's no Jesus. And without Jesus, there's no grace. So I'm just all right in my mind to take both and be happy about that, praise God. Hallelujah, thank you, Lord. As born-again believers, one thing we must understand, and that's the grace of God. You've got to understand the grace of God. Amen. If you have an understanding of what grace is all about, you'll walk better. You'll feel better. You'll act better. You'll speak better. I'm serious, church. This is what God gave me. I just need to share it with the ones who I love. I want to be right with God, because the last thing I want to do out of all the things that God can have me do, when I come to that point when I need to meet my God, the last thing I want him to do to me is say, well, I remember when my grace was with you and you did not. I don't want that to happen for me. Amen. In my 67 plus years, I do not want that. God done took me too far, brought me too long to fall down now and not get up, not get back up. Am I talking right, mother? I need to walk in the grace of God every day of my life. Lord knows I need grace with these grandchildren. Lord knows I need grace with these things and that things. But God said my grace is sufficient. Paul, a mighty man, Paul, a mighty apostle, Paul. The grace of God was upon Paul, but Paul still had a thorn in his flesh. He couldn't understand why. Lord, I did this in your name. I did that in your name. I healed. I delivered churches. I built this and built that. I'm here. I'm there. I'm everywhere in your name. Lord Jesus, I obeyed everything you said. Why do I need this thorn in my flesh? All I can say to Paul, I know you don't hear me, Paul. But if he could hear me, I say, Paul, be in God's grace. Be thankful, amen, that God used you in that capacity and only gave you a thorn in the flesh. Because God knows what's best, and God does not forget where you came from. You know, when you persecute the church like Paul did, when you kill thousands of Christians like Paul did, when you talked all kind of mess like Paul talked and acted and had blood on his hands all kinds of ways, and God just gave him a thorn in the flesh, but used him to his glory and his praise, that tells me that God's grace is sufficient. God's grace is God. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. We are saved by grace through faith in Christ Jesus, as is pointed out in Titus 2:11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men. Did you hear that? For the grace of God, not because of anything else of God, God highlights the grace that brought salvation to all men. Amen. And women. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Because in Romans 6:14, let's go to Romans 6. That's one of my chapters here. Romans 6. Amen. And we'll read just right down to, from 14 right down to 23. It says here in Romans 6:14. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. Hallelujah. Do you hear me, church? This is Paul talking to church at Rome. For sin shall not have dominion over you. I talk to you tonight, today, saints, sin will not have dominion over you. Amen. Hallelujah. For ye are not under the law. but under grace.
Amen.
See, when you understand the law, put a highlight, put a light on sin, on sinful man. But grace, hallelujah, brought you into Jesus Christ as Lord. Hallelujah. And the Savior of the world. God had a divine plan and he put it in place. He says, then, or what then shall we sin? Because we are not under the law, but under grace. God forbid. Oh, yes, God forbid. Don't try to take advantage of the grace of God. Let me caution you now. You know, God has done some miraculous things, godly things, that cannot be figured out by man. And sometimes the blessings come so good and such on time, you say, Lord, this got to be you.
Amen.
This got to be you, Lord, because I can't figure out how I got blessed this way.
Amen.
But it's only by the grace of God, but don't take advantage of God's grace.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Be a good soldier of the Lord.
Yeah.
When you say you love God, be available.
Amen.
Be available to God. See, God loves you, and he's not going to take anything away from you. You know something? That is so wonderful. When God has given you something, he don't take it away.
Amen, that's right.
The money God gave you in your job, you ain't to worry about. God ain't going to take that money from you. You lose that money, you lost it yourself. Or you want to blame it on the devil, go ahead. You know something? Okay. We blame Satan for everything. Everything. And I've heard it. You've heard it. I've said it. You said it. Satan did this. Satan did that. The devil a lie. This, that. Devil's this. Devil's that. This, that. You know, some. For me, and I'm going to speak for Minister West. Before you start accusing the devil to do something, you better make sure you right. That you didn't bring this on yourself. That you didn't get this problem yourself. Amen. We're good at pointing the blame, but we need to turn the finger right around, you know what I mean? Yeah. When trouble comes, and it's unexpected trouble, praise God. You didn't invite it, you don't want it, but it came upon you. You can count on God's grace to take you through this thing. Even when you don't have the answer, God says, you know, that is my child.
Right.
Satan, you may turn him around, but you're going to take your hands off my child. Satan, you may take this from them, but don't touch that.
Amen.
You might try to take them out of their mind, but you're not going to take them out of their mind because they're my child.
Amen.
Take your filthy hands off my children. Grace abounds. Amen. Hallelujah. When sin thinks it has its control, grace abounds and it will take you through. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. He says, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves, servants obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart.
Amen.
That form of doctrine.
Amen.
Which was delivered.
Amen.
Unto you.
Amen.
Being made then free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
We've been free from sin, saints.
Yes.
And now we are the servants of righteousness.
Yes.
Not by our own strength. Not by our own demise, but by the grace of God. God stepped in and interceded in your life and in my life. It's automatic. It's automatic, praise God. How many times when you had gone about your way, thinking everything was all right, something started, something happened, and God finished it? That's right. God stepped in just as quick as it tried to step in.
Amen.
And God fixed it.
Amen.
Amen. That's grace.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And if you walk right with God and talk right with God and behave ourselves.
Come on.
Behave ourselves. and cut out the foolishness. Lord Jesus, we can walk in the Spirit, walk in grace, and God will pour out blessings where there's no room enough to contain it. God has a storehouse. Yes, he does. God's got some gifts and blessings that you and I will never see. You know why? Because they're too deep. Unless you get to that place, you get to that level where God says, I'm going to pour out a blessing on you. You know something? I'm going to speak a prophetic word right now. My young brother, Joshua Watkins. Do you believe God is sending him around the world for nothing? I believe God got a plan. I believe God got a plan for this young man. It's international. This is just not, you know, local stuff. God is preparing this man. And I speak it in the atmosphere, and I pray, God, that God, you touch him right now in the name of Jesus. That God is preparing him for international ministry. Hallelujah. You know God is capable. You know that, don't you? I just joy when I see him. Because he's got the right spirit. You know who I'm talking about. We're talking about our son, Joshua. The walking son, Joshua. Amen. Hallelujah. He just got that right spirit. And God, I'm like, he's where? I said, we where? Singapore. Japan. God is taking him all over the world. God don't make no mistakes. God has purpose for what he does. International ministry, I pray, you pray, amen, on his behalf, that God continue to work with him, amen, and let that ministry come forth with power, hallelujah, global ministry. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. Here we go. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. Amen. I speak after the manner of man because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanliness and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness and what? Holiness. Paul's talking it now. Paul's preaching it now. He says, yield your members to the grace of God so holiness can prevail in your life. So holiness can take a place in your life. So holiness can surface in your life. Walk in grace. Hallelujah. Let God do it and God will fulfill it. Praise God. He says, for when ye were the servants of sin, ye were free from righteousness. What fruit have ye then in those things whereof ye are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. Oh, my God. Paul's getting pretty tough now. He's letting them know there ain't no playing with the grace of God. There's no playing with what God has put in place. There's no playing with your calling. There's no playing with your walk. You need to be right with God and take it very serious. Because we're dealing with a serious God. Oh, my Lord. When you think of what God has done, when you think of what God has endured with mankind, what God on his throne has seen with his very eyes, the bloodshed, the terrible things that have gone from generation to generation, the children, the widows, the women, the men, the young men, all those who have perished, God is not playing in the year 2017. As the pastor said the other day, there is a judgment upon the world. We're under judgment. Amen. Hallelujah. But the Bible says here in verse 22, but now being made free from sin and become servants of God, ye have your fruit unto holiness. And the end, everlasting life. My God. Holiness and everlasting life. My God. I can't wait. Am I getting tired?
Mother, am I getting tired? I'm not tired yet. Thank you, Mother. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. Can the church say amen?
Amen,
amen again.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Yes. Praise God.
Yes.
My God, my God. God has placed everything in place because of God's grace. It's got to come through the grace of God if it's going to be anything at all. So I love the Lord with all my heart, and I'm thankful for what God has done, but it's a wonderful blessing to understand and get a little deeper in the grace of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord Jesus. Grace has the power. Amen. It has the power to operate through ministry. The Holy Spirit, hallelujah, is the grace of God. The grace of God is upon Christ. The grace of God was upon the apostles. And Paul referenced it when he said, let your speech always be with grace.
Amen.
Let your speech always. Some of us got to work on that.
Amen.
Me included.
Amen.
That my speech be of grace. That I speak the right thing. If I can't say the right thing, don't say nothing. But if you like to talk, talk in grace. Say the right thing. That's what Paul said. Hallelujah. You better speak the right thing now. You want to please the Lord? Speak the right thing. Say the right thing. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And grace, in the grace of God is upon you. Praise God. Hallelujah. Grace hasn't lost its power. My God. But be strong in grace that is in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Grace. Grace is the unmerited faith or unmerited favor, mercy, compassion, acceptance, kindness, graciousness, goodwill, in a divine assistance of God. That's what whole lot said. The divine life, power, and ability of God flowing and operating through us in order to give us supernatural power and ability for ministry and sanctification. Hallelujah. Grace is defined as undeserved blessing. Undeserved blessing. You know, I was reading those illustrations I started out with, and there was one where, a short one, I'm not going to read it, but I can go by memory. And it was one where this Christian family, very faithful in going to church, and the mother would always prepare the little son she had to go to church, and they had communion every week, and it was a communion Sunday, and the mother took the little boy with her, as usual. And normally, she would never give him an offering. She'd take care of the offering herself. So the little boy was accustomed to that. And then, this particular Sunday, the mother gave the little boy a dime and said, put it in the offering. Little boy looked at it with amazement and said, okay, fine, no problem. Church started, everything was well. Got to the point of communion. Communion plate, offering plate came around. The mother put the offering in. The little boy put the dime in. The communion wine came around. Bread cream came around. Mother got to the mother. The mother took her portion. Plate went right by the little boy. The little boy grabbed the plate and started to take the wine off the plate. The mother said, don't take that. You cannot have that. You know what the little boy said? He said, why? I paid for it. What? He said, why? Why can't I have communion? Because I paid for it. Well, that is a childlike adult attitude.
Amen.
Amen. That's what that's all about. Praise God. Our attitude, praise God, as adults. We think that something can be purchased just because we do it, that God is pleased with it. God ain't pleased with nothing we got. God ain't pleased with nothing we do. You know why we get blessed? Because of the grace of God. We don't deserve nothing. Come on, church. If you believe you deserve anything from God, I need you to stand up and we can talk about it. But if you've got, if you're thinking right, you understand that I don't deserve nothing. I don't care how long you've been saved, sanctified, and Holy Ghost filled, you cannot convince God that you deserve anything. Amen. If that don't humble you, it humbles me. It helps keep me on track, my feet on the ground. I don't care how much I labor for God. I do it because God loves me. God saved me. God has given me grace to accomplish anything that I do in His name. And I don't take any credit. You know what I'm talking about. But the problem is, well, why does this happen to me? Why does that happen to me? I did this. I did that. I'm faithful. I pay my tithes. I do this. I'm always at the pastor's side. I'm always here. I'm always there.
That's right.
So what? So what? You don't even deserve jack. Can I say that, Pastor? I don't deserve jack. It's only by the grace of God that I am anything at all. Oh, thank the Lord. But the Bible says God will not share His glory with nobody. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Man is messed up. I'm going to tell you, man is all messed up. We all messed up. We've got this thing so confused. Oh, thank be to God. God put this covenant grace in place. All right, because see what God, as I said earlier, God ain't going to take it back from us. When God ain't that way. God ain't that way. He's holy. He's righteous. He's loving. He's kind. He's all those things we talked about already. Amen. But that wonderful thing called grace is undeserved blessing. It's a free gift. God's loving mercy toward mankind.
Yes, that's right.
I mean, amen. What kind of God is this that would love us in the midst of all the stuff and dirt and sin and degradation that we do? What kind of God would love us? Oh, my God. My Lord. It's a God that His agape, I guess His agape love fits it right in. This is only God's type of love. We cannot feel it down here. You got to be around the throne to get a taste of His great, great love. Praise God. And you know, one day we hope to be, just let me in, Lord. Just let me be close to that. That's all I need. Just, Lord, let me in. Praise God. I'm running for my life. Oh, glory to God. Thank be to God for the grace of God. Because without the grace of God, I wouldn't make it. We wouldn't make it, children of God. We wouldn't make it. We wouldn't make it one bit. Praise God. God's disposition to exercise goodwill toward all His creatures. Hallelujah. According to the scripture, the law was given to show us, I think I mentioned that we are sinful. But the grace of God was given to turn us to God. And we can find that in Ephesians 2, 4 through 10. We're talking about saving grace. We're talking about enabling grace. We're talking about grace to die to self and to submit to God. That sounds like the three graces to me. To be saved from sins, sanctified holy, and filled with the Holy Ghost and that with fire, praise God. Oh, glory to God. Three graces. And we thank God for all things. But even those three graces can't match up to the grace of God, because without grace, you wouldn't have the three graces. Hallelujah, glory to God. Let's go to James. Let's go to James. James chapter 6. Amen, hallelujah. Glory to God, James chapter 6. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, I'm just encouraged this morning. I'm thankful this morning. I'm excited what God is doing. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to his name. Thank you, Jesus. Can somebody praise the Lord? Can you give God praise? Oh, glory to God. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus. Glory to his name. James in chapter 6, praise God. I think I shot past that. Oh, I'm sorry, sis. Amen, amen. Hallelujah, glory to God. James chapter 5. Hallelujah, hallelujah, glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Let's go here. James chapter 5, verse 7. He says, be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for the purchased fruit of the earth, and hath long patience for it, until he receive the early and latter rain. Be ye as patient, establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. We can't be playing around. The God is coming soon. Jesus is coming soon. And we need to be ready with God. So we need to walk, hallelujah, in the grace of God. And be content, praise God, for what God is doing in our lives. Hallelujah, glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord. Bless the reading of the word. Thank you, Lord. Grudge not one against another, brethren, lest ye be condemned. Behold, the judge stands before the door. Oh, my God. James is speaking it, praise God. There's no room for isms and schisms in the church, in the household of faith. Amen. Come clean. Come clean and let God purge out the old leaven and make you a new lump before God. Hallelujah, praise God. You know, I know about me, I'm trusting God. Amen, amen. When God said, I'm going to put you on a new track, I'm going to put you in a new direction, I say, thank be to God. Amen. God is not finished with me yet. Praise the Lord. He says, therefore, my brethren, the prophet who have spoken in the name of the Lord, for an example suffereth affliction and of patience. Praise God. Behold, we count them happy which endure. Amen, amen. You need to be happy in Jesus because you know Jesus personally. You're not ashamed to call on the Lord and stand up as a witness to the Lord Jesus Christ. So many of the saints, they come into the house of God, but you wonder sometime what moves them. Because they don't move. I'm stepping on somebody's feet now. Right? I got to speak it like I speak it. The word of God comes week after week from this spot. Moves out, praise God, believing that God has opened up your ears and opened up your heart to receive God's word. But week after week, month after month, no movement. No change. No stepping out by faith. No saying, I love you, Lord, and I just lay it out before you. I don't know how you're going to deal with me at the altar, Lord. But, Lord, your grace will take me through. Your grace is on the floor. Your grace is in the atmosphere. Your grace is all about me. I believe in your grace. So, Lord, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to step out. I got stuff going on in my life. I don't need to talk to God about it. God already know. He's like the woman at the well. He already know how many husbands she had. Amen. And the one she was with was not even her husband at the time. But you know what he said? He said, go get your husband and you will come back here. Go get your stuff. Go get your stuff and bring it at the altar. Go get your stuff and bring it at the altar so I can fix it. Because God can fix it. Amen, but you got to step out of self. You got to get out of your fleshly ways, walk in the spirit, and say, Lord, I don't know it all. I don't know how you're going to deal with me, but I'm going to trust you for it. I'm going to believe you for it. Because grace has not lost its power. Grace is still working today, praise God. Grace is still able, hallelujah, to bring a conversion, a change, a new direction in someone's life. Lord, I don't want you to tell me I should have been over here when I was here. I want all that God would give. And if it's the Holy Spirit, I want the Holy Ghost. And I want to be able to walk in grace in this last and evil day. I don't want to have no trouble with nobody, but nobody wants to mess with me because I've got power. I'm going to be a loving Christian. I'm going to love everybody. I'm going to do all I can to honor the living God, but don't cross this line. Don't cross this line because I'm going to tell you who Jesus is. Am I right, evangelist? Praise God. I'm going to tell you who Jesus is. Hallelujah. Oh, sometimes I think we need to be brought back to our own way. Oh, landmark. The old days. I'll never, never, never forget the old days. When it was automatic, you'd see chairs lined up across the altar. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Saints expected to get on their knees then. And pray too. Tarry until they be endued with power. My God, hallelujah. I remember when God touched me, oh my Lord. Oh, my God, those are some days. My God, I didn't even think I knew how to spell Jesus twice good. I was that new in Christ. All I know is that when I came into the house of God over there across the way, I was in the pew, and the next thing I knew, I was on my face at the altar. Amen. Somebody said my shoes were still in the pew. I came out of my shoes coming down to the pew, to the altar. And I stayed there until God filled me with the Holy Spirit. Amen, amen. Where are those saints today? Where are those soldiers today? The Bible says in Hebrews 4:6, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace. Where's the boldness in the Lord today? No, excuse me. God has got the boldness. We lack the boldness. We lack the boldness. If I say I love the Lord, and God says he's got a gift for me, I should be right up here waiting for my gift. Saying, Lord, do whatever you have to do to me to get my gift, because I believe I want power in the Holy Ghost. Fire baptized in Jesus' name. But it will come through the grace of God. It will come through God's love towards you, his devotion to his children, his love and mercy and kindness and graciousness. God pours out these things upon you and I each and every day, unmerited. We weren't deserving of it all. But God did it, and God will continue to do it. Amen. Until he decides a better thing. Amen, amen. But right now we're under grace, and we ought to love it, and we ought to appreciate it, and we ought to give God the glory for it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Grace. It's greater than our sins. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace. Hallelujah. Nothing can touch it. Nothing come near it. Except holy lives. Holy devotions. Desires to touch the hem of Jesus. Amen. That's the ones who will be blessed so greatly for it. In the name of Jesus. But don't worry about it. The Bible tells us that God reigns on the just as well as the unjust. That's how deep grace is. Even the sinner man is blessed by grace. Do you realize that? I mean, that puts a measure a little bit on how deep this thing is. God has no respect to person. He ain't like us. He don't look this way and then look the other way over there. He looked you straight on. And he looked right into your heart. And he shows love.
Yes,
and he shows all those godly qualities that only he has. Isn't that wonderful? Grace has not lost its power. Grace is alive and well because God established it before the foundations of the world. The covenant of grace. And it moves out just like the air moves every day. Amen. You don't know what direction it's coming from, but it's there. Every single day, we are the recipient of God's blessing. And it's a wonderful blessing to have grace in our lives so greatly. Amen? Hallelujah. So be encouraged, church. Because you can find favor with God. Grace brings favor. Grace gives God's attention directly to you when you cry out to him. And when you stand in faith and believe in God, and you walk in grace, nobody can tell you any different. That God will deliver and God will provide. Amen, amen, hallelujah. Oh, I can see a house full of saints of God walking in grace. Oh, glory to God, the power we would have. God will rain down upon the people of God in such a mighty way. Hallelujah. If we'd only would get us out of ourselves and move this stuff out of the way, that's not like God. Ask God to purge it from our life. Sanctify it from our life. Get me right with you, Jesus, so I can be a blessing to someone. Mother said it earlier, God ain't going to bless nobody if your heart ain't right. God ain't going to use you if you're not right with God. Because God has a host of angels. A host of others, praise God, that are walking right and God will use. But you will not escape falling short of God's glory. God will look at you. He may shake his head on you. Praise be to God, if you're washed in the blood, you won't lose salvation. But praise be to God, God could do a whole lot more with you if we only allow him to do it. Amen? Praise be to God.
This is Pastor Watkins from Community Revival Outreach Ministries. I trust that you enjoyed that wonderful service we just had, and I trust the Lord that it touched your heart and your spirit, and it also inspired your soul. But beyond just listening to a message, we also ask you to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And how you do that, you just simply ask and bow before Christ. And if you're willing to lay hands upon your TV or bow your heads right where you are or sitting, if you just bow here with me and we'll pray the prayer of faith. Heavenly Father, we truly thank you for all things in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that you forgive us of all our sins and have mercy upon our soul. And that not only you save us, O Lord, from our sins, but, O Lord, that you would sanctify our hearts and sanctify our souls, as well as, O Lord, baptize us with the Holy Ghost and that with fire. We accept you, O Lord, into our hearts and our life. We confess our sins and we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that God raised him from the dead. And by believing and accepting this, O Lord, we claim to be saved in his holy name. We give thanks and praise for all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I trust the Lord that your heart is fixed with the Lord and that your blessing will be assured and that you'll come out and fellowship with us. And if not with us, your own local church in your area, and that God will be a blessing to you until we see you again. Take care and God bless. Bye-bye.